hey YouTubers. And in this tutorial, we're going to have a look at Arduino and interfacing it with LCD displays. Now, what we need to also look at in this tutorial is libraries, because libraries can fundamentally play quite an important part in interfacing Arduino with various hardware and hardware shields. So we're going to go down, we're going to look at the various types of displays, the potential pros and cons. We're going to look at how to install libraries, how to potentially troubleshoot some issues with libraries, because with the later versions of the Arduino software or IDE, when you install a library, sometimes you have issues because the libraries you're installing were specifically designed around the previous versions of IDE. So we'll go around troubleshooting that. So we will get down and have a look at some detailed code that so that we can actually run and display something on one of these LCDs. But don't get too caught up in that actual detail and that actual code and how to wire your Arduino into your board, because that is going to vary from display to display. There are so many different types of displays. There are the kind of more cheaper common ones with 16 pins, which have a parallel data output, and then you've got the serial enabled ones, which is what I'm going to demonstrate to you. And they can be wired in differently. And depending on the library that you have, your commands that you send to display things might be different. But if you have a grasp of the overall concepts and methodology around that, I'm going to give you some help in terms of how to understand, how to build up and get to the point where you can get these running with your Arduino. So let's get down to the bench. Right, so the first thing we'll kind of have a look at is the different types of displays and the things to be wary about. Now, I have only a very small selection of displays. You get high definition displays, color displays. They come in all shapes and sizes. But if you're getting started out and want to kind of display an output from your Arduino as opposed to sending the output to the terminal on your computer, it means you can have your Arduino freestanding, and let's say you want to have a simple project that measures temperature, then obviously you can display it on the display. We're going to move on from this and have a basic voltmeter. We would like a liquid crystal display to do that. Now, the most common type of displays that you'll find around for Arduino are these ones with these 16 pins. So you can see you've got a whole lot of pins here. Some of them kind of enable the device for reading and writing. Some control backlight. You've got your VCC and ground to actually power it. And then you've got your data pins. And obviously the data is actually sent in parallel to devices like this. So certainly the positive side of devices like this is that they cost only a few dollars. On eBay you can get these literally for $2 to $5 if you hunt around. The ones that I have are often two-line displays, are either like 2x16 or 2x20. This one over here happens to be a 4x20. Now, the disadvantage of these cheaper ones with the kind of multiple pins is that you need a lot more, you're going to consume many more of your data I/O or your digital I/O pins on your Arduino itself. So as you can see on this larger display, I've got some wires connected up to it. You could have a header connected up like this one over here, and then what you can simply do is obviously place the board in a breadboard and have interconnecting wires going over to your Arduino. But you're going to lose quite a few of your inputs on your Arduino board. Now, in some cases, you don't have to use all the actual pins or connectors coming out of the display. Most commonly, you'll have 8 pins that address your display, and sometimes you can get away with using less. However, what I will be demonstrating in this video and using are serial enabled displays. Now, the one disadvantage about serial enabled displays is that they cost a bit more. They're going to cost tens of dollars as opposed to, you know, up to $5 or so. The advantage is that you only literally have 3 wires connecting to it. So you've got obviously a VCC to power it and a ground, and then you've got a data cable. And that data cable sends data into it, and the actual display itself can decode the serial data coming through and then send it to the display.
And on the Arduino board itself, the kind of pins that you'll be interfacing, or the input you're going to be interfacing, are these over here. And you actually tell your software which ones you're using. So by default, you'll see you've got pin 0, which is a receive pin, and then you've got pin 1, which is a transmit pin, and then you've got the other pins. But you can software define which you want your I/O pin to be, set as output, sending the data to the display. Now, once we get down to, we're going to get down to the computer and have a look at these. The code that you use to write to these, the complexity of that in your software can depend on the software library. And the software libraries basically enable you a simpler way of programming and interfacing with your displays. Now, the one problem I initially had was that the first display I got, I was trying to send a float variable. So that's a floating point variable because I was doing the digital voltmeter, and obviously it needed decimal places. And I was trying to send a float variable to the display, and my software wouldn't compile. It was falling over with an error. And I at the time thought it was related to the hardware, but as it turns out, it was the specific library that I was using. So those are things to be wary about, that most of the time, if your software is falling over with an error, you've got to look at your own code and potentially a limitation within the library. So let's get down to the computer and just have a look at that.
Right, so the first thing we're going to have a look at is obviously installing a library. Now, the one thing I want to highlight is if you look at the top here, you can see I'm using Arduino 1.0.5, and as of kind of September in 2013, that's the latest software off the site. So I've gone into the folder, and these would be the kind of default folders and directories that you'd see once you've gone and unzipped and placed this on your computer. So if I fire up the Arduino IDE, or the place where we write sketches, you can obviously note the version number there. Now, if we go to Sketch and Import Library, you can actually see a list of the default libraries that are already included in the software. And as you can see, they to either to write to EEPROMs or for Ethernet, GSM. They've even got one here for Liquid Crystal. But this one over here is 99% is for one of the normal displays with the 16 pins. And it doesn't have anything by default for the type of display that I've got, the serial enabled one, which is made by SparkFun. What you need to do is go onto the SparkFun website and download the zip file which has got the library. Now, once you've got it downloaded, Arduino 1.0.5 has got a new feature where it allows you to add a library from straight from a zip file. Previously, you had to unzip it yourself and put it somewhere. But what you can do is go to Add Library, point this to, when it comes up and prompts you for a location, you can point this to the location of that zip file, and then it'll install it. The other way is to simply copy the files into your library folder. So if I close the software, I'm going to go into the library folder. So it's always handy to know where this is, because later on when you see we have a bit of a problem, we need to come in here to actually fix it. And here you can see those folders with the actual libraries in them. And just to show you what's there, so the important files in a library are, you'll have this .h file, which is a header file. The CPP, which is where most of the code for the actual library is contained. You'll have a keywords file, which has got some of the keywords and definitions which are noted inside the library itself. I've actually, over here, you can see that. So this is one handy place, because if you've pulled up an example where you're trying to write some code and you just want to quickly check what the kind of keywords are that you can use, or commands, you can actually come over here and have a quick look. You'll then have an examples folder where they normally give you some sample piece of software, so at least you can get you started and you can adapt that for your own program that you're writing. Right, so now that we've got this folder, I can actually then copy into that. I've already gone and downloaded the SparkSuff LCD library. I'm going to copy that straight into this folder. So as you can see, I haven't gone through the kind of add and install process. I've just copied the actual library in here, and again you can see it's got the header file, the CPP with the actual code and the keywords. And if I go up one level now to where my software is, if I fire up the Arduino software and go and have a look at Sketch, Import Library, you'll note down here SparkSoft LCD. Now, had you done this the other way, where you actually do add library, it'll actually add it to the bottom of the list here with a kind of header onto it. If you want to remove this software, all you need to simply do is go and remove it out of that folder. But anyway, so we've got the software, the library in there now. So right, once you've done that, then you can come over here to File, and you've got this examples in over here. And these are examples which can get you started off in Arduino. So if you're playing with some basics in terms of blinking lights and what have you, you've got code ready here, so you don't have to go digging around on the internet or write it yourself. You can look at it and try and learn from that. But also, the libraries then incorporate their examples here. And if we go down to SparkSoft LCD, it's got an example. You click on it, and as you can see, it's pulled up some sample code. And basically what it's doing here, we'll go through a simpler version of this just to see what it is doing, but it's just sending something out to the display. It does an arm and it displays some characters on the screen. But if I go now and to try and verify this, and obviously when you try and upload, before you upload, it'll automatically verify. But if I click on verify, we may come across a few challenges. So what I'm going to do is open up this window over here, so that we can see the dialogue. And we can see things going, and there we can see we've got an error in compiling. So something to note here, and this stands for any other troubleshooting that you're doing. Obviously the window over here is showing what it's doing while it's actually trying to upload, to check the code and then upload and compile it. The white means obviously that things are going fine, and where you kind of get this orangey red, those are potential issues or warnings. Now, for the most part, you don't have to worry. You'll get some warnings, but it can get past those warnings. And as long as, so what you need to do is get to the point where you get the kind of red-orange writing and no more white. And what you need to do is look at the first line after the white text, because that is potentially where your issue lies. Because once you've got the failure here, things after that fail as a result of this first error. So as we can see here, the error is wconstants.h, so the header file for wconstants, it says no such file or directory. So this is a problem with the, because of the later software and using older libraries, the older libraries within themselves make references to files which potentially aren't there. So what I would do, I would go and find these files and then go and copy them into a hardware folder and then run again, find where it hiccups again, go find that file and go put it in. But that's the kind of wrong way to do it, because you're always going to bash your head against this. So what we need to do is go into the SparkFun library and change the ref where it tries to reference this to Arduino.h. So let's go and do that. So here we go. If we go into the libraries file and we go to SparkSoft LCD, and if we have a look at the CPP file, so this is the one with the main code. Now I'm going to open it to edit it. It's not going to look that pretty because the default editor is not wrapping nicely. But what you want to do, you can either go and do a file and a search, or edit search and find that file that you're looking for. I happen to know that it's sitting over here. So I'm highlighting over here. Over here you can see in blue, it's got an include, because this library is relying on this other file. But the change is that you don't need to rely on that file, you just type in your Arduino. So as you can see, I've typed in the Arduino, and then I just go file, save, close it. And if I come up and try and go again, bingo. It's compiled, it's got right to the end with no errors. So that potentially you can hit your head against with all kinds of libraries. So that's just a tip, I say, when you're using the older libraries with the new Arduino software, that's what you need to do, is go into the library, find the where you, it's hiccuping and not finding the file, and change it to Arduino.h.
Right, so now we've managed to install that SparkFun LCD library. We've gone and resolved the issue. Now obviously what you want to do is download the latest library, because hopefully the new libraries won't have that issue where they're referring to a file that's no longer there. But at least now you know how to troubleshoot it and get around it. So let's just chat a bit about the libraries and what they're there for. Now, what I'm going to show you on the PC after this chat is basically the contents of that CPP file and the code in there. Now, what you'll realize is that the code in there can be quite complicated. There are certain control characters that have to be sent to the LCD display or whatever hardware you might be using. There's certain timing that has to be done. So it gets very complex in terms of the coding to communicate with that LCD. Now, all that code in the library, in fact, could be in your main sketch. You could have that all being addressed in your main sketch, but if you're, for one, it's going to make your sketch look very bulky and there's going to be a lot of excess code in there that you perhaps don't want. And as a beginner, that's going to be very intimidating having that in there and trying to troubleshoot and understand, get a basic writing to the display. So that's why libraries are written. They're written to take the burden off the actual sketch, the main sketch itself, and they tuck it into a library, and then they have simple functions which refer to that library so that you've got a function that basically says, go to this part of the display and write this message. But that go to is a function that's defined inside the library, and there's a lot of extra code in there that actually does the work. So that's the one great thing about libraries. Now, the one not so great thing about, well, there's a pro and a con to libraries. They are written by people like you and me, or let's say SparkFun. So potentially SparkFun might go and write a library and have a certain amount of functionality in there. Or they might even have a mistake or an error in there. As I described earlier, like one of the libraries I was using, I couldn't use the float variable. So there might be certain limitations, but because it's an open source community, often people will go and correct and update those. What I also want to show you, once I've shown you the insides of the library and how it all works, is that you can potentially go and write a library yourself. Once you've got to a more advanced user, and you may decide that you only want simple functionality, and that's fine and that's great if it fulfills your needs. But you may find that, let's say, you want to go and write fancy character sets onto the display. How do you do that if it's not contained in the library? Well, that's potentially where we need to go and have a look at the data sheets for the actual piece of hardware, and there from there you can go look at the code required and either include that in your main IDE or your main sketch, or write a library yourself. Right, so what I've got here is a sketch which is also comes off the Arduino site, and again I'll post a link below. A gent put this together, and basically he did this to address a serial enabled 4x20 line LCD display. So the one important thing I want to highlight is that at the top here, he starts off, he sets up the serial port. So he's writing out to the serial port. So basically this will write out through output through pin 1. And then he starts his main part of the program, and he starts off by saying clear LCD. But over here is where you'd normally declare or say you're including a certain hardware library. So in this code, you can see this code is not relying on any library at all, but yet it can still work and it writes out to the display. But there's a command here that says clear LCD, and of course that isn't a standard Arduino command. And if we go down a little further, so he's clear LCD, it says put the backlight on, he's got a delay that you should recognize, and there's a serial print, and it's got something inverted commas where it's printing out. There's a delay, and then it's writing something else. But if we go down to the lower part of the code here, he's gone and written some functions which go and define those commands. So he's got a function here which goes and defines a select line 1, select line 2, go to the clear LCD over here. And in here you can see he's got serial write 0xFE. So that isn't very friendly, but this is what you'd be doing if you weren't relying on a hardware library. You'd have to know the hardware codes specific to the LCD display or piece of hardware that you're writing to, and then actually send them here. It certainly is possible to talk to hardware without a library, but as you can see, it's not the most friendly. So let's now have a look at the actual hardware data sheets for your LCD to get an understanding of where this comes from.
Right, so the first thing I want to point you to then is the Arduino site, because the Arduino site itself obviously has the latest IDE software that you can download for your Arduino board, and it has loads of helpful tutorials and information. In particular, they've got one here on liquid crystal displays, and I'll add a link below. But what they do, and the reason I'm pointing this out, is although I'm going to be covering serial enabled displays, most of these tutorials are on the kind of 16-pin type. And they'll go through, they'll explain what libraries to use, they'll talk about the pinouts and what the individual pins do, and they then even supply a diagram on how to connect them up. What I've pulled up here is an information sheet that SparkFun Electronics provide, and this particularly relates to the actual display that I've got, the serial enabled display, and there are various versions of it in terms of size. But on here, they will go and describe the hardware. And some of the critical, interesting information is to note the kind of hardware. So you'll get an LCD controller, and in this case, it's the HD44780. So there are some very common hardware types that run these displays. And in there, you can see it actually is giving you a list of some of the LCD commands. And this is where you can go to an information sheet like this and actually look these up and then use them yourself in your code if you're getting to a point where you either finding a library might be limiting, or you want to might get to some more advanced features or understand at a lower level what's going on. And then in particular, you can go a step further. You can see they actually mention a data sheet here for the particular display. So let's bring that up. So here we go. This is the data sheet, and as you can see, it's the HD44780U. And it's a Hitachi display. And if you go through this, this really gives you a breakdown of the hardware and how it works. The voltages, the resolution, it'll talk about like the, it'll give you block diagrams of the ICs, the timing that has to happen for the LCD to actually work. And even if we go down a little further, it'll even give you a mapping for the actual dot matrix display. So you could go and design your own character sets if you get down to this level and actually do that yourself. So if, for instance, your library doesn't enable you to do that, you could either do this in your Arduino sketch, or even if you're going to use it over and over again, it's then easier to actually produce a library by yourself. And on the Arduino site, they actually describe how you can go about producing your own library. So again, I'll put the link in here. It talks about installing libraries, and there's also another section about actually writing your own library yourself. Right, so the next thing what we want to do is we want to wire up the serial enabled display to our Arduino kit. Now, as I said, it is far easier than one of the cheaper, let's say 16-pin ones, because you don't have to deal with a whole lot more connections. In many cases, you have to have a resistor to control the current going to the backlight, or you have to have a potentiometer to control the LCD display. But on this one, as it so happens, just by wiring up these three, you can get it working. So I must say, it's one of the reasons I also chose this. It's very easy to work with. So on mine, I happen to be using this Scooby-Doo wire or telephone wire, which is solid core, and that can be a bit fiddly. You might want to take this into a breadboard and use your own jumpers. But as I said, on this one, I've got the black and the kind of orange here, and we'll just zoom into the Arduino to show where they go. So something to note is on your Arduino board, we've obviously got a ground down here, and we've got a 3.3 volt and a 5 volt output. So what you need to make sure is that you check the power or the voltage requirement for your display. If you have a display that works off 3.3 volts and you plug it into the 5, there's a chance that you could damage it. This one does work off 5, so all I need to do is go ahead and plug that into the 5 volt and the ground. So there we go, I've got the voltage supply, the VCC and 5 volts to the display. I then have my data line, and in this case, I know that that software is addressing pin 1. So you've got pin 0 over here, and then you've got pin 1 over there. So that is where that is going to go in. So all I need to do now is literally take this over to the PC, connect my USB cable, upload the code, and let's see if it displays.
Right, so I've gone over to the PC and I've shown you in previous tutorials obviously how to go and upload code. I've uploaded it, and what I'm going to do over here, I'm simply going to use the USB port here on the bench to actually power Arduino. So there we go, boots up, and there we go. That's that piece of code. It's just simply showing how to address line 1, line 2, line 3, line 4, put some stars, and then also it'll actually fade out the backlight. It does some fading of the backlight. That's not clear to see in the lighting here, but there we go. Straightforward, and that's how you can start to get and address the display. Now let's look at another example.
Right, so what I've gone and done here, we've got the previous code, which as I said has got no reference to a library at all. I've now gone and pulled in the example from the SparkSoft library, which is obviously contained once you've gone and loaded the library into your Arduino software. Now, here's an acknowledgement to the person who actually wrote it. So just be aware of that you always want to acknowledge the original person. I've gone and edited this down so it's just a little bit simpler to follow. But the important things to note here is this hash include. And this is how you tell your code that it needs to include and upload to your Arduino and make reference to potentially a library. So here we go, in inverted commas, sparksoft.lcd.h. So that's a reference to the library, and that's what you need to do to be able to use the library in your code. Now what it's gone and done over here, it's got this hash define, which is one way of defining a constant variable. There's another way of doing it, but here we go, the constant variable is called lcd_tx, and it's given it the number 2. Then here in the code, it's got a reference to the library, sparksoft.lcd. And what this line is actually doing, it's defining an easy command that you can use within your code. Because in your code, you're going to be using commands that don't exist in the default library of commands for Arduino, and that's what where this library is going to help us. So we're going to say for this code that we're using, we want to be able to use the word LCD. So it's referring to the library LCD, and it's saying equals, and then it refers to the library, the reference where it's being used, and it's got to reference the SparkSoft library and pass the parameter LCD_tx. Now this is actually defining the pin which is going to be used for the output, as we'll see later. So obviously the number 2 is going to be passed back to the library, and we'll have a look at why that is, because the library itself is going to communicate directly with the output, and it needs to know what pin that you're going to be using. You could go and define your own name here if you wanted to, and in fact what you could do is actually say LCD2 and say SparkSoft LCD and have a different number here, and you could perhaps drive two displays at the same time. And this is the fun about experimenting with Arduino. So here we go, we now get to the part in the code where we do our setup, and here it's got this command pin mode, and obviously it's referring to a variable which is 2 in this case. So it's saying pin mode pin number 2, set it to output, because you can define whether these pins are input or output. So that's a definition there. And now you can see we've got a reference to this LCD and then dot begin, and then it's referencing the speed. So here is where it's starting to make reference to the library. And as you can see, we've got a command here that says lcd.clear. So it is referring back to the library. Now this is called, as I said, this is a constructor, and the command afterwards is an instance. So this instance is actually referring to a function in the library. If we had to go and have a look at the library, we'll see there's a function that's written for this word clear, so you don't have to have a lot of code. So this is, that is what it's doing. And as you can see, again, more codes, lcd.cursor, and then we've got a delay, which is a standard command. We then get to our main piece of programming, and as you can see, all I've done here is I've got LCD, I've said go LCD cursor 2, that's setting a type of cursor. You can see it says block style blinking cursor, and again the code to get a blinking cursor is far more complicated, but that's all contained in the library. But as you can see, it makes the code within your sketch very simple. You have to use very simple coding to go and write to the display. I'm here telling it to go to cursor 2, 1,1. So that's saying go to the first column and the first row and to write hello YouTubers. There's then a delay, and then telling it to go to the second row, so the row is the first reference here, and then the first column, and then I'm telling it to print something else, and so on. So as you can see, it's very simple in terms of your code once you have a library backing up. But of course, and that's what I wanted to say, these commands will obviously vary from library to library, so it's pointless thinking or trying to learn parrot fashion that writing to a display is going to be lcd.cursor, because that will vary depending on the library that you're using. And that's where these examples are helpful, because you can see what commands they're using or the names of the functions that they're using inside that library. Right, so let's just quickly go and have a look at the contents of the library. This is getting to the more advanced stuff, but it just gives you a little bit of understanding the back end. So here we're looking at the header file, and again, there's the on the Arduino site, they describe the format that you have to do inside a library to get a library working. But in the header file, it basically defines the some of the functions and the variable types that they're going to be using. So you can actually see some of the commands here where they talk about certain print commands or move, clear, cursor to. Those are the high level bits of code. The main code is actually happening here inside the Sparksoft LCD CPP file. So if we go have a look at that, you can actually see down here that change that we made to Arduino.h, because the library itself is referring to bits of code that are other bits of code which are required. So it wants Arduino.h, and it's referring to its own lcd.h, the header file where it's got the high level stuff. And then we go through some references, and if we go down further here, we'll actually see where it's got a reference here to transmit pin. And through its code, you'll see the code actually gets fairly complicated, where it's talking about bit period, clock cycles, and this is the type of stuff that you, perhaps when you're beginning to do this stuff, you don't want to have a full understanding of this, and you don't want to have it in your code complicating things. But as I said, when you do get down to low level and have a look at the hardware sheets, this could become very helpful to provide some more advanced functionality. But here you can see where it refers to transmit pin. That is where the variable is being passed back, so that this piece of code, the library, knows what to talk to. But this is what the library looks like, and all the complicated code that can potentially be inside there. But as I say, you can potentially write one of these yourself. It doesn't need to be complicated. You may find some functionality that you may want to add, so you can go and update or even start a library yourself. Right, so now we're back to that piece of code, the example that's provided here, the Sparksoft LCD. As you can see, as I've shown you before, it's very straightforward. Just by looking at this, you could easily go and adapt this yourself to go and write something to the display. You could, as opposed to kind of text, which is in inverted commas here, you could put a variable so that if you were, let's say, trying to write a temperature reading from an input, you could put a variable inside here so it writes the variable to the display. You could have a counter, but all of that we will show in the next video when we do the actual voltmeter to see how you can manipulate this to display things that you want. So I'm going to just quickly click the verify and make sure that the code is verifying okay. And if we go and have a look, yes, there were no errors. So the next thing I'm going to do is upload it so we can have a look at it.
Right, so I've gone and uploaded the code to the Arduino. I'm just about to power it on to see if it works. So there we go, it's firing up. Oh dear, nothing on the display. Why not? So a few things to be wary of. For one, I've still got my data connected to pin 1. And remember, in that code, we defined pin 2 as the one which had the code being sent to it. So I need to switch this across. Something else to be wary of, though. Sometimes you might have a case where when you send, if you've got the LCD display connected to your Arduino when you're uploading things, you might get a whole lot of gibberish on your display, and it might not then actually display the text that you've actually sent to it. Depending on the library or how well the library is written, sometimes it might sit in the communications might be enabled while the actual boot and upload is happening, and there might be gibberish being sent down the data line to your display. So in that case, what you want to do is either power off or unplug your data while the Arduino boots and then plug it in to get your display working. Now there, you might decide that you don't like that because you want your Arduino to work perfectly each time. That may only happen during the upload, but to get around that, you may need to look for another library which handles the communications or disables the communications in a better way. But let's just move the pin across. So if I move it across to pin 2, you can see we've got some gibberish on the display as I did that, but here we go. We've got our display working, it's coming up with a message. So some of the fun challenges once you start getting this going is like, I've got this printing on the second line, a delay with something else on the line. This can take time to get right. Sometimes you have to kind of count where you're going to put something, it doesn't end up in the right space. So that all comes down to formatting and playing around. But that's part of the fun to get that right. And I say, we'll see some of the challenges that we have with this once we get to the voltmeter display and perhaps writing a clock or updates to the display constantly.
Right, so I hope the tutorial has been of use. As I said from the outset, the idea here is not to give you specific information on the actual words and code to use or the actual library, because that's going to vary according to the hardware that you use. So ultimately what you want to do is go away and for your application, find the display that works for you. I started off with a two-line display and realized that perhaps I went and changed it because I thought I had a hardware issue to a four-line display, but ultimately the four-line display for me was perfect because for the project that we're going to have a look at, four lines were what I needed. But with that, then you want to understand, is there a library for it to make my life easier when I'm trying to write code for it? And now potentially that you understand that the potential issues you can come up against, you can have some idea on how to troubleshoot those. You may not have exactly the same error codes, but you now know where to go and have a look. You can know where to go and reference the library, and potentially that you can make a change in the library to go and get around that. Or go and search the forums and numerous areas where kind of the open source people are discussing the issues that they've had. Anyway, if you gain any value, please give it a thumbs up, and I'll catch you soon for the next video. Cheers.